Hey, hey, people. Seth here. Today, I'll be reviewing Might and Magic 8, Day of a Destroyer, following directly on from the events that took place in Might and Magic 7. The story begins in Ravenshore, the fantasy equivalent of Bradford, England, a vibrant and multicultural city of many diverse races, with their main exports being crime and grape juice accessories. One day, a robed middle-class man appears in the market square and goes for a walk, as an ogre attempts to culturally enrich him with his club. The peaceful ogre is flung away and suffers racially motivated fractures, but before he's able to sue, the man makes a run for it, conjuring a gigantic crystal crib on the spot and locking the front door. The crystal erupts, opening up portals to all four of the elemental planes and triggering Armageddon in the world of Enroth. So, let's recap on what the fuck is going on with this story. Might and Magic 6, devil aliens come to Enroth, you kill them and nuke their starship. Might and Magic 7, devil aliens come to Arathia, you kill them and nuke their starship. Might and Magic 8, the ancient AOL account just received mail. There's devil aliens on Enroth, please send help. So the aliens dispatch the android Eschaton to Jadam, which is east of Enroth, to nuke the whole planet. Let's forget that this is a planet home to Titans, dragons, and Johnny Depp. You start off as a caravan guard for the Dark Elf Merchants Guild, escorting a shipment of grape juice and grape juice accessories in the Dagger Wound Islands. As the elemental plane of Earth opens up, the nearby volcano starts swallowing up the islands, but more importantly, swallowing up the consumer base and profits of the Merchants Guild. You're ordered to resolve this Armageddon crisis, close off the elemental planes, and beat up the android causing this, all on minimum wage with unpaid overtime. On the way, you might even find a devil alien nest on Jadam, and nuke that too, if you want. No one really gives a fuck about the Kriegans at this point. Might and Magic 8 is a strange game, and that's probably for the best. It builds on concepts established in the previous games and cranks them up to 11. This time, you only design a single character, the leader of your party. The rest of your team is filled by adventurers found throughout the world who need to be convinced to join your party. You can no longer kidnap random townspeople to help you on your quest, which the game makes up for by extending your party size to 5. Party members can be swapped out at any time at the Adventurer's Guild, which allows you to reform your team with different characters in any major city. The character class system from before has been destroyed. In its place is complete madness. Classes are now tied to races, and many races are classes. Doesn't make too much sense? Too bad. Might and Magic 8 adds racial abilities to each of the different races you can have in your party, much like in real life, where Caucasians possess the power of white guilt, and sand people have the ability to transform clocks into a device that can tell you the current time. Vampires can suck dick, levitate, and turn into gas. Trolls regenerate almost instantly. Dark elves learn the arts of the chosen people to make lucrative trade deals and hex goyim who can't pay off their credit loans. Minotaurs are actually paladins with hooves, and the human classes are pretty self-explanatory. The knight is illiterate, the cleric can touch wounds and altar boys, and the necromancer can skellify himself to become a power lich. Dragons can fly and breathe fire. They can also insta-kill anything with one attack. The only enemy in the entire world of Jadam that can withstand a dragon's assault is a sewer rat, because their hitbox is too small for the dragon's projectile to actually hit them. The gameplay is more of the same formula of quest solving, beehive crawling, bee killing, and collecting jars of bee honey to sell off at the market. And really, that's all we came here for. If there's a big RPG you're excited for in the coming years, ask yourself a question. Is there going to be a bee level? If not, why not? Put pressure on modern developers. It's unacceptable that in 2017, if a small Korean boy plays a Western RPG, he's more likely to see a sewer level than a bee level. One day, this boy will grow up and say to himself, "Man, I wish I knew what bees looked like, because I'm horribly allergic to them," as he walks headfirst into a nest and is stung to death. His blood will be on your hands, Western game devs. But I digress. To progress, you'll need to forge alliances with different in-game factions, such as the Catholic Church or the Necromancer's Guild, and the Dragons or the YMCA that fights dragons. There's lots of side content and shenanigans to keep you well entertained, such as the aforementioned Archomage Tournament and all the numerous promotion quests needed to actually unlock your race's highest abilities. The game will easily keep you occupied for several dozen hours at least. Over the course of a story, your main character brings all the the races of Jadam together to put their differences aside and work together to fight their common enemy, Eschaton. It turns out all the elementals are running wild because their respective elemental lords have been imprisoned by Eschaton. Sadly, the keys to the prison are held by Eschaton himself, so you have to forcibly barge your way into his crib, and then, for the first time in gaming history, you have to successfully answer the antagonist password recovery questions to win the game. After verifying that you're the owner of the AOL account, Eschaton hands you the keys. So you free the elemental lords, they blow up the crystal, and Eschaton's crib gets trashed. Then an Amazon drone pops out of his chest. The end. But not really. Might and Magic 9 comes out, the publisher goes bankrupt, Ubisoft buys the rights to the franchise, and turns it into Hearthstone. And now they're close to being bought out by Vivendi. What more is there to say? The game is amazing. 10 out of 10. Go play it. As always, more content to come, so stay tuned. A big thanks to the many members of the Alvar Merchants Guild, funding these videos with grape juice and grape juice accessories. Have a good one.